Hi, my name is Vivek Singhal. Welcome to this introduction to AI and machine learning webinar. I am a co-founder and chief data scientist at CellStrat. Okay, and today I'll introduce the concept of artificial intelligence and machine learning and how it's changing our world. I welcome you all. Happy New Year, and we have great hopes about AI discoveries this year and skilling on machine learning and AI, and hoping to achieve some major breakthroughs in AI innovation. All right, so let's start here. First, an introduction to CellStrat. My startup is a leading AI startup in India. We specialize in R&D in emerging areas of AI and deep learning, and machine learning and deep learning. We are working on multiple innovations for selected industry verticals. For example, healthcare, financial services, retail, and so on. We are very strong in research and content development for AI and data science domain. We are very active on social media channels for AI work, AI content, and we are connected to the global AI communities. And we run AI research lab, a global AI research lab, a group which is working on cutting edge of AI and machine learning. Okay, so it's a global group with a local in-person local chapter in Bengaluru, India. But our AI lab is really now a global organization with members from across the world. Okay, let me see. I see just a moment, please. So there's a question here. Your number, please. Okay, so I'm going to just write my number here for benefit of all. I've just communicated my number to you all, and so if you want to be added to our global WhatsApp community, you can contact me. All right, and you're already part of our meetup group. We conduct a lot of webinars and seminars here in India, as well as global webinars through online channel. I won't be able to note your number here while on this call, so you'll have to contact me on my number or just email me to our meetup group, and I'll be able to add you to our global WhatsApp community. Okay, so let me just continue here. So as I was saying, we are an AI startup based in India, but now we run a global AI research lab with global membership. And it is a very unique product in the sense that very few AI research labs exist in the entire world, let alone in India. So our teams are working on some cutting edge innovation in computer vision, NLP, predictive analytics, reinforcement learning, and so on. So let me just go ahead in the interest of time. So that's just a brief intro about myself. I was based in the US, Atlanta specifically, for 16 years. My last job was with AT&T. I was a lead solution architect. I came back to India in 2012 and to my native country, and have worked with IBM for 2 years. And last few years, I've been trying multiple startups. So CellStrat is my recent startup, and I am an AI data scientist myself. We publish a lot of AI and machine learning content. I teach machine learning and deep learning. We have courses, and our AI research lab is working on multiple product development activity in computer vision, image prediction, language, time series, and so on. We have a lot of content which you'll find on our website blog, and we provide research and training for multiple corporate customers as well. Let me continue here. So I do have a lot of content to cover today in the short hour today, so I'm going to be really fast here. You can just keep asking me questions as and when you feel like. I'll answer them periodically. So what is happening now? Why AI suddenly proliferated? Why such a huge hype? You know, in 2019 is said to be the biggest phenomena in technology world this year. So we thought it's apt to start this new year with an intro to AI webinar. That's how this webinar came about. So, in earlier we had Industry 1.0, where steam engines were invented, electrical communication, chemical. Then we have Industry 2.0, where radio and telephony got invented. And then we had Industry 3.0 until about 2000, where we had semiconductor revolution, you know, automation and automated plants and electronics. And then now we are entering the age of Industry 4.0, where, you know, it's cognitive artificial intelligence, where IoT devices are powering machines and providing cognitive AI, you know, data. And there's high degree of personalization. So all the social media companies know us very well, more than we know ourselves. And they are able to, you know, personalize the offers and products for us. Okay, and we are entering an area of artificial intelligence and machine learning, which will make the world completely different in a couple of years. Okay, so world will look very much different than what it looks now in next 5 years. Let's continue here. So the one of the reasons for the some of the phenomena which we see, data is the new oil. You know, companies which are sitting on huge amount of data pretty much control the world today. And folks like, you know, IDC research company have said that we'll be dealing with 180 zettabytes of data, 180 followed by 21 zeros, you know. And so it's a very long, big number. And the data is powering n number of AI services which are revenue generating, whether it be face recognition, whether it be Google search, whether it be language translation, whether it be hardware chatbots, driverless cars, it goes on and on. Now there's a data network effect. So the companies which are able to collect a lot of data are able to personalize the offers and attract more users. These users generate even more data, and this data helps improve the services of these companies even further, and this attracts even more users. So there's a virtuous effect for companies which are able to do a data circulation or a lot of data collection. Companies like Google, Facebook, Twitter, you know, Apple, or Microsoft, right? So companies which are collecting a lot of data are able to use it to personalize the services even further and really drive, you know, a further growth for themselves. So that's why some of the regulators are now stepping in, trying to check the, you know, unlimited power of these tech companies around the world. And we see regulatory behavior in different countries, including USA, Europe, India, etc. Okay. And you can see the chart, the number of companies mentioning AI in their quarterly earnings calls is just proliferating. So AI is becoming an AI first word, basically. So in the last few years, we have been hearing about cloud first, mobile first. Now it's becoming AI first word. Okay. So let's just get our basic definitions out of the way. What is artificial intelligence? Okay. Just a moment, please. I clicked on the wrong link. It triggered a YouTube. So artificial intelligence refers to intelligence in machines. And basically, we are trying to simulate human intelligence. So the most simplest of definition says that we are trying to simulate human-style intelligence in machines. So just like we can take decisions about various things, what to say, what we see, and what we need to do next. You know, AI is able to do the same things now. And there are tons and tons of applications, and there's no limit to them, like robotics, computer vision, image recognition, face detection, text mining, text analysis, self-driving vehicles, AI in retail and gaming. You know, for example, personalizing the offers on an e-commerce website, credit scoring, fraud detection, banking, anti-money laundering operations, NLP, and so on and so forth. And many of you would have tried Alexa, Cortana, or Siri chatbots. And these are hardware chatbots along with software layer. And many of us have tried to buy the Echo Dot device from Amazon or Google Assistant. And we are now ordering our cabs and food by talking to the internet, right? So voice is the new interface to the internet. And they're using extreme amount of AI technology to do speech understanding and speech recognition. In the image, you can see the IBM Watson robot, which IBM always displays at its conferences. You know, you can check out the Google on it, a YouTube video on it. Now, the next thing is machine learning. So it's a branch of AI. And machine learning is basically the set of mathematical techniques or data science techniques by which we train AI. So ML is said to be a branch of AI, but it is that area of that area of science or data science through which we train AI, right? So it facilitates the creation of artificially intelligent machines. And here we simply train you know, machines by feeding it x y data. So input x, output y. For example, you know, trying to predict diabetes, you know, predictions, predicting diabetes among a set of population. So x would be the lifestyle factors, the demographic factors of that population set, and y would be the probability of getting a diabetes disease, right? So that would be one application of machine learning. And so here we are building algorithms that allow computers to learn to perform tasks. So instead of explicitly programming the rules, the relationship between x and y, we are using historical data to train machines to derive the relationship between x and y. So basically, it will discover a relation between x and y of this kind. And this is said to be my learned model or learned machine learning algorithm. And using this learned algorithm, then I can predict a new output y for any new input x, right? So if this was diabetes prediction, I can use a trained model to predict diabetes for a new incoming patient, right? Okay, let's continue here. So now comes deep learning. What is deep learning? It is a specialized form of machine learning, and it uses networks of interconnected computation units called neurons. So those circles you see on the right, they are called neurons, right? And we were inspired about deep learning and what we, these are called artificial neural networks. So we got inspiration of this from the functioning of the human brain. Human brain uses billions, B as in, you know, Bengaluru or Bombay or Bing. So, you know, human brain has billions of these neurons which are forming connections, breaking connections all the time. And these neurons work in conjunction to do complex decisioning. All right. So these are called artificial neural networks as opposed to biological neural networks, right? That's why the word artificial. And this is very useful for complex applications for like image processing or speech recognition, right? So for example, this is an image provided to us, a photo, a PNG or JPEG file. And our problem statement is to detect whether this image has a car, a person or an animal. So the way deep learning, which is a specialized form of machine learning works is it takes input pixels. This is a pixel, pixel, pixel. You know, as each image has a pixel, as you know, there's a lots of pixels. It takes these pixels as input neurons. And the first hidden layer of neurons find the edges, right? So if there are two adjacent neurons and there's an RGB value, as you know, RGB value, correct? And RGB value one, RGB value 2. If the RGB value changes, that means there is an edge here, right? So this is how the first hidden layer detects edges. The second hidden layer, you know, find corners and contours by combining the edges, right? And the third hidden layer combines the corners and contours to, you know, make complete object part. For example, this could be an eye or a nose or a mouth. And then the final output layer concatenates all the object parts to predict whether the image has a car, a person or an animal, right? So I call this the divide and conquer mechanism of a neural network. All right. So this is a specialized form of machine learning, and this is powering more advanced applications like image or computer vision, speech recognition, driverless cars, gaming, and so on. All right. Any questions so far? Okay, let me just proceed forward. So some of the key features of machine learning. So we looked at two kinds of machine learning, classic machine learning and deep learning, which is more specialized form of machine learning. So machine learning is very computing intensive, particularly the deep neural networks, which you saw on the previous slide. The problem is that, you know, all those neurons means a lot of mathematical computation. There's a lot of matrix multiplication going on. So for machine learning, everything is data, whether it's an image file, a speech file, a text file, it converts it into numerical vectors and matrices, right? So machine learning is always operating on numbers, not really image per se or speech file per se. All of that gets converted into internal numbers represented by mathematical vectors and matrices. So it's very computing intensive for all that huge computation cycles. It will involve repeated retraining. We have to train the model again and again and again to find accuracy in the model, all right? So we'll typically run, let's say, 10,000 training iterations. or 1 million training iterations or something like that. It needs a lot of training data. So I need a lot of training data, like X1, Y1, X2, Y2, right? So I need a lot of such training data. We have, input X, output Y, input X, output Y. So let's say if this is diabetes prediction. This is the input parameters for a patient number one. This is the probability of that patient getting diabetes. This is known data, by the way, so historical data. This is patient number two, demographic and lifestyle information. This is the probability of patient number two getting, diabetes, the probability of getting diabetes for patient number two. So this is historical data. Using this, the model will basically discover a relationship between X and Y, and using this trained model, I'll be able to predict output Y, the probability of getting diabetes for any new patient X, right? Now, as more data gets added in the system, machine learning training has to be rerun, because now it has to relearn the new data as well. So we can automate machine learning for learning new data patterns and adapting the algorithm by learning from new spam words or new speech, for example. So this is called incremental learning. So incremental learning refers to the fact that we are retraining our trained model so that it can now train on new incoming data as well, which has been generated after the last training iteration. Okay, let me continue here. So what are the major applications of AI and machine learning? So there are countless, but we have just listed a couple of them here. For example, image face detection, object detection, identifying suspicious people in a group of people in a photo, or detecting cars on the road and number plates of the cars, speech recognition for voice chatbots, right, and language translation services, then banking and finance, like money laundering or fraud detection or credit card, or just reconciling your balance sheets, and then healthcare for predicting all kinds of diseases and conditions, driverless car, which is coming a big area, and then of course robotics. Okay, robotics would be where a robot is working on industrial shop floor and helping the human labor perform certain tasks, right? Or a home robots. What are other areas of healthcare it is used? A question which has come in, what are other areas of healthcare it is used? See, healthcare, they're like predicting disease, right? Lifestyle diseases like thyroidism, diabetes, cardiac risk, obesity, predicting genetic behavior of future kids. I mean, it can have malicious implications as well, unfortunately. Predicting cancer or life-threatening diseases, right? Checking radiological images for deformities and cancers in the bone or chest x-rays, right? So numerous applications for predicting and detecting disease or deformity in human body, okay? Okay, so you need specialized hardware or cluster of computers for machine learning? Yes, so typically we require more high performance computing, or HPC computers as we call them. So small models we can run on our home laptops as well, which have high i7 processor from Intel or AMD or Mac. But large scale machine learning requires typically cloud computing or large server farm. Okay. Having a good background in mathematics, necessity of AI ML, also known algo concepts, and Python. So what are the skills needed? Let me just hold that question till we come to the career counseling question. Okay. How is ML applied to driverless cars? Fair question. So, what is a driverless car? A car which knows how to drive itself, right? So it has to observe images on. So if a car is going here, right? There's a car going here. Let me try to draw a car for you. Right, not a good shape, but just bear with it for me. So a car is going right, so it has to figure out if there are cars on the left, on the right, if there is some obstruction in the front. It has to read the road signs which are along the way, right? And it has to figure out what speed it should drive at, right? What should be the correct speed as per the speed limit, and avoid all obstruction, pedestrians, the neighborhood cars, and stay in the lane, right? In developed countries, cars stay in the lane. Maybe not so much in India, but in advanced countries, cars tend to stay in the lane, right? And when to change the lane, when to take the exit. So huge amount of reinforcement learning, computer vision, predictive analytics going on. So a driverless car is loaded with artificial intelligence, all right? It's nothing but a very large box of AI moving on the road. Okay, let me just continue for now. We'll come to some more questions later. So there are a lot of interesting applications of AI. So we already saw that, IBM supercomputer Deep Blue beat the Garry Kasparov, the world chess champion at that time, or grandmaster, in 1997. After that, Kasparov wrote a very emotional book about how AI is going to beat humans. So you may want to check out Kasparov's book on Amazon.com. And recently we heard that Google's DeepMind division, the AI division of Google, based in London, they beat the world champion of the game of Go. So this is a game played popularly in Korea and China, the Eastern Hemisphere, and not so much in India, I believe, or USA, I believe. So it is a very hard game to master, because you can see there are infinite combinations of these, darts which you can have. But so for the first time, a machine was able to beat the reigning world champion at that time, Lee Sedol. And then, in fact, in September of 2017, Google's DeepMind created Alpha Zero program, which learned the game without a human player being involved. In 4 hours, it learned all possible moves of this game. And now it is so advanced. Recently, they also said they have learned all possible moves of the chess game, right? So this is just an application of AI. Then banking, this robot is installed in the Worli branch, Worli Mumbai branch of HDFC Bank, an Indian bank in Mumbai. And apparently, I have not been there, but I have read about this use case. So if you walk into it, it will basically recognize you by your face. And it will say, "Hello, Mr. Singhal, how are you today? How can I help you?" And I can talk to it and say, "Ira, please tell me my bank balance," and it will display the bank balance on that screen there, right? So in the Web3 Industry Revolution 3.0, we had mobile and web banking. Now we have cognitive, assistance using robots and chatbots in the era of Industrial Revolution 4.0, the era of AI, if you will. Then we are very well familiar with driverless car concept. And very many countries are currently undergoing trials for driverless cars. So this will help prevent accidents and also help solve the problem of driver shortage, for example, trucking or cab drivers. But yes, an unfortunate impact could be some of the folks can lose their jobs, folks who are driving trucks or cabs. But mostly it's for the positive side, because it will help prevent accidents and a lot of deaths which happen in accidents around the world. Here you can see an example of object detection, and this can be used in a cashierless store. So if you see in the image on the top right, a computer vision program is predicting whether a certain soda can is having Sprite or Crush, which are Coke brands, I believe, or Pepsi or Coke, I forgot which one. And then in the image on the bottom left, you can see that I'm pinpointing the objects on a shelf. And we can use this for a automated shopping cart, and you can enable a a cashierless store using these kind of technologies. Okay, you can see it's always assigning a probability to the object. It is assigning a probability to the object. So machine learning is an approximate science; it works on probabilities. So for things like retail checkouts or e-commerce sales, a probability of 80-90% probably can suffix. But as you can imagine, for healthcare or driverless car, I would really like 99.9999% accuracy on my model, because the danger is otherwise somebody is likely to die, right? So depends on the use case, how much probability you are willing to tolerate, okay? So now let's understand the difference between traditional, business analytics or data analytics, or even software engineering, and machine learning. So what changed? Okay, so earlier if you are from IT team, you provided a problem or a requirements document, right? Recover a product specification document, and then your development team will code the program as per the specifications, and then you'll send it to your quality assurance team. Your QA team will test using test cases, And if the program passes the test cases, it is deployed in production. If the program fails, it is sent back for review of errors, right? So it could be sent back to the development team, or it could be sent back to the requirements team, product management team, right? This is traditional software development lifecycle or IT lifecycle, isn't it? So what changed in machine learning? Let's see on the next slide. So the basic process is still same, but the key difference is here, I'm not hard coding the rules. I'm training, the model here. So by feeding, historical training data, okay? So as I said, if it is diabetes prediction model, this is patient number one, this is patient number two. So X represents their lifestyle and demographic information, for example, their past, disease history. And then Y would represent the probability, the fact whether they had diabetes, yes or no, in the past, right? So this is historical patient data for diabetes prediction. And then I train a model which will re-engineer or basically learn the relationship between X and Y, right? And then, or reverse engineer the relationship between X and Y. And now it has found the relationship between X and Y. This is said to be, this is what we call as a learned machine learning model or learned algorithm. We send it for something we call as testing step. We test the hypothesis. So let's call this a hypothesis. We test this algorithm or hypothesis using some test data. So we feed some test data here. If it passes the test, we deploy this model in production. If it fails the test, we send it back for retraining and review. So this kind of, this model will continue like tens of thousands of times or millions of times till the accuracy on the test data is good enough, and then that's when we'll put it in production. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, I assume all is good. Let me continue here. So now let's look at some major categories of machine learning algorithms, right? So machine learning uses, data science algorithms. So there is some overlap with data science. So machine learning uses classic data science algorithms like regression or classification. And so machine learning is what connects AI with data science in that sense. So both are sometimes used interchangeably, but there could be a fine line difference between data science and machine learning and AI. But sometimes we might use those terms interchangeably. So let's not get confused with semantics. When people say data science, they often mean AI and machine learning and vice versa, okay? But technically there could be a fine line difference. But basically it's all data science algorithms which form the basis for machine learning. So the first class of machine learning algos is classification or categorization. For example, so there is some samples on this side of the line, there are some samples on this side of the line. It's trying to find the classifier line between these two kinds of samples, class A, B, or C, or just class A or B. Then it's trend analysis. I have some points here. I'm trying to fit them, find the equation of the line which fits the dots, right? And so this is called trend analysis. Anomaly detection is detecting the odd man out. For example, credit card fraud, right? Detecting fraudulent credit card or banking transactions. Organizing data into clusters and deciding on future action, which we refer to as reinforcement learning. So let's look at each of them in slightly more detail in the next few slides. So the first class, major class of machine learning algorithms is reclassification. Here we are simply trying to answer whether a product belongs to, or an item belongs to class A or class B. For example, is an email spam or ham? Ham means good email, okay? Ham means good email. So is an email spam or not spam, or in other words, ham? Should the bank issue a bank loan or not for housing or buying a vehicle? Will the kid pass the exam or not, right? Will the patient develop diabetes, yes or no, right? So something like that. Will a certain president win election again? Yes or no, right? So these are all classification questions. You can also have multi-class classification. You need not have just two classes. You can have n number of classes. I could have hundreds of classes or even thousands of classes. For example, in this graphic, is this vehicle belonging to the type minivan, a car, or a truck, right? Is a bank customer belonging to high risk, medium risk, or low risk category? Three possible classes. A news article, is it about politics, sports, culture, or entertainment, right? So when a news feed comes in, what category it belongs to, all right? So this is what it meant by classification set of algorithms. Let's continue here. The second type of algorithm which we mentioned before is trend analysis, which we call as regression. So here these blue dots are the input data, okay? The blue dots are the input data. The equation of the red line, the equation of the red line, it could look something like this. Y is equal to 7x plus 5, right? The equation of the red line is what the model is going to learn. See, in traditional IT analytics, traditional data analytics, the red line would be the input. It would be hard-coded, right? But in machine learning, the equation of the red line is learned by observing those blue dots, those data samples. Each blue dot has an XY value, isn't it? On this coordinate geometry chart. This is where your high school maths kicks into play, right? So maths is back with full vengeance, if you will. And you can notice this value 5 because it is crossing the origin of x at y equal to 5. Because if I put x equal to 0, this is simply equal to 5, correct? So if x is 0, then y is equal to 5. So this value is called the bias or offset from origin. 7 is the slope of this line. And if you remember from high school days, the slope of a line is represented by y2 minus the y1 divided by x2 minus x1, correct? So the 7 represents the slope of the line. We used to often write this as y is equal to mx plus b, right? If you remember from your high school algebra class. Instead of m, now we use the letter w. W simply means weights. I could have more than one input feature. So I may have something like w1 x1. Sorry, w1 x1 plus w2 x2, right? So for example, for house price prediction, so x1 could represent the size of the house, x2 represents the age of the house, and w1 and w2 represents the respective weights. We call them weights, okay? In vector notation, we write this in short form as w dot product x. So there w can have multiple, you know, values, and x has multiple values. All right. So this is used for a trend analysis, for example, predicting continuous values. For example, price of an apartment in a city, or how much will it rain? What is the performance rating on a contiguous scale of 1 to 5? Right. So this is different from classification. Classification, where it was whether it belongs to class A or B. Here I'm trying to predict the value on a continuous distributed line. Okay. Let's continue here. Now, anomaly detection represents something called an unsupervised learning algorithm. And here we are trying to predict, you know, the odd man out. So this could be my credit card transaction, and I'm not able to recognize these two, you know, transactions on my monthly credit card statement. So this is an anomaly. This is called anomaly detection. Okay, I'm getting a lot of career counseling questions. Kindly hold that thought, I'll come to them. Okay, how data is organized. So this is another unsupervised learning algorithm. So here I'm trying to classify stuff into two clusters. Here I only have X information, Y is missing. Right, so given a set of fruits, I'm trying to classify fruits into citrus category fruits or gourd category fruits. Gourd fruits are actually vegetables, isn't it? They are not really sweet fruits. Sweet citrus fruits are fruits, but gourd fruits are more like vegetables. But they are, from a biology point of view, they are still fruits. So I'm trying to classify a fruit into gourd fruit or citrus fruit. So this is called clustering. Okay. One type of machine learning algorithm. Let me continue. Then this is a new algorithm which is becoming very popular in the coming year. So here, this is called reinforcement learning or rewards-based learning. So here we train an agent. An agent could be a robot, a driverless car, or even a video game agent. So it does certain action, and based on certain action, it is given a reward by the environment. Then the agent moves to next state, right? So this constant action reward state behavior is what we call as reinforcement learning. If the agent gets a reward for certain action A, then it learns to repeat that action A. So by giving rewards to an agent, we teach the agent what actions to replicate or repeat. Okay, this is called rewards-based, incentive-based learning or reinforcement learning. So this is becoming very popular, you know, nowadays. And this year is supposed to be the year of reinforcement learning in AI world. It is a more advanced and more nuanced form of machine learning. Let's continue here. So we looked at some common AI products like Apple Siri. We have experienced these products, Microsoft Cortana chatbot in our Microsoft Windows computers, Google Assistant, Amazon Echo device, IBM Watson, and so on, right? Some of you might be familiar with these products. Apple Siri is quite popularly used with Apple iPhones. So what has happened is that earlier you have to develop all these machine learning algorithms using low-level Java, Python, R, etc. Now companies like Google, Apache Foundation, IBM, Amazon, you know, they have Facebook, they have created high-level programming stacks. So TensorFlow is probably the most popular deep learning stack, and you can develop neural networks with TensorFlow API, but you can use any of the other ones as well, okay? So now there are high-level APIs for us development folks to develop AI applications more easily. Before, we had to do a lot of this programming using low-level Python or Java code or C++ code, okay? But now life is simpler with these high-level APIs. Okay, so now I come to a very hot topic, which a lot of questions seem to be coming. But let me just address some of the technical questions before I go there. Sorry, I went a little fast, just in interest of time, because I wanted to cover quite a bit of material. So I'll try to answer any open questions now. Okay. So you need specialized hardware, yes. So preferably we need GPUs or graphic processing units, right? GPU has more high performance computing capability than a traditional CPU. So you can buy CPU or GPU, you know, tiers on something like Amazon Web Service or Google Cloud, right? Or even run small models on your desktop computer or laptop. Having a good background in maths, necessity of AI ML, or knowing algo concept and Python libraries is enough to proceed. See, machine learning is all maths, but it's not very difficult. If you have studied maths till 10th grade, high school or senior school, you'll be fine. In our machine learning courses, we start with a chapter on maths first. We revise your mathematics from your high school days, just enough to make you comfortable with machine learning concepts. So machine learning, you know, courses have three parts. One is theory or intuition of an algorithm. The second is the algorithm itself, right? The logical algorithm. And the third is the programming. So theory, mathematical algorithm, and programming, all three are equally important. Okay. And yes, it involves maths, but it's high school, senior school level maths, so it's not very difficult. How is ML applied to driverless cars? I think we already sort of discussed that. It uses vision, reinforcement learning, predictive analytics, and so on. Next question is, when to choose between algo like random forest or XGBoost and deep neural network for classification? See, there is a principle called KISS, keep it simple, right? So if a random forest, support vector machine, decision tree, or logistic regression is helping you solve your classification problem, why to complicate it further, right? If it is not, if classic ML fails to do the job, then you can try something called XGBoost, which is a boosting algorithm. Or if that also doesn't work, you bring in the horsepower of a deep neural network. So you go in that order. You keep it simple, KISS principle. Start with basic algorithms, classic ML algorithms. If it doesn't work, you go towards deep learning. In other words, deep neural network. Deep neural network are the powerhouses, you know, horse. They provide a lot of horsepower for complex problem solving. So DNN or deep neural network is said to be a universal approximator, which means that it can find the relationship between any X and Y, however complicated the relationship is. But we don't want to implement DNN unless we have figured out the classic ML is not able to help us. how do we determine the accuracy of learned algorithm when evaluating test data? I mean, algorithm could perform well with X amount of data and might not well perform well with Y amount of test data. So wanted to understand, is there a criteria that algorithm has performed? See, it depends on the domain and the use case, right? So if I am trying to predict, books to sell on Amazon.com website, which Amazon website actually does, then it can afford to be only 80-90% accurate and still, be fine. But when I'm trying to predict cancer, I need to be 99.99% accurate, right? I cannot afford to make a mistake in let's say healthcare prediction or driverless car. Because if my model, my prediction is wrong, somebody may, there may be an adverse, circumstance which might happen and somebody might die, right? So depends on the use case. How much accuracy your domain can tolerate, right? And you need enough data. If data is less, you have to bring more data or you have to fine tune your model. So there's a lot of model tuning involved in machine learning and deep learning to tune the model for the kind of data you have. Sometimes you need to tune the model. Sometimes you have to bring more data. Sometimes you have to do both of them. Machine learning unfortunately suffers from this problem of overfitting, right? So if you don't have enough data, it will overfit a small amount of data, and then it will not be able to generalize to new kinds of situations which happen in production. For example, if I am training a diabetes prediction model for population of New York, then you can't expect me to take that model and apply it to other countries in Europe and Asia, right? Because it is very hyper-tuned for New York population only. Right, so the propensity to get diabetes could vary in different cities and countries. So this is called the problem of overfitting. What is the scope for testing professional? See, AI and machine learning offers a huge new world for anybody to skill in. All right, so we are training sales managers, HR managers, program managers, testing, QA, of course, developers. Pretty much AI is open for all. Because all of us studied high school maths, right? So if you studied high school maths, you can get into AI, right? If you are scared of high school maths, then yes, it may not be a very good area for you. But even then, if you are not going to be programming, then you can be just an application consultant in AI. So we'll come to that in a moment. Do we need to revisit high school maths? So in most of the good courses, they will refresh your high school maths. We do that in our courses as well, okay? This session is being recorded. Yes, it will be available on our YouTube channel. Let me now come to some of the career counseling questions, which will help you answer many of these already. So, the demand for data scientists in AI and machine learning is, it's just accelerating like crazy. There's just not enough people in this space. Okay. So that's the only point of this slide. So for every day, there are 50 open positions in data science and machine learning. There's only one or two people available for 50 positions. So that's why the salaries are through the roof. If you are expert in AI and machine learning in Silicon Valley, you can ask for a $1 million package at least. In a city like Bengaluru also, many of the ML experts are getting 1 crore packages easily in top companies like Amazon, Flipkart, etc. Okay, so the demand for this kind of talent is just amazing. And it's a hard area to learn. I'm not going to, belittle that point. It's a hard area to learn. It is a long, steep learning curve. It's hard, right? So that's why very few people are able to train in this compared to the demand. But the opportunity is so amazing because it impacts every area as we know it. So this slide will help answer some of those queries which were being asked. So, there can be two kinds of careers in AI. So I'm just clubbing overall AI ML data science here. So if you are a technical person or willing to refresh your programming skill, then you can follow the technical track. If you don't want to be in programming part of it, you can still become an AI solution specialist, right? So as I said, we have got HR folks, sales and marketing folks, consulting, project and program managers, QA folks, marketing folks taking AI courses. So there are quite a few material available for non-technical, non-programming folks also too. Become AI specialists, right? We still need marketing folks, HR folks specialized in AI. In future, I don't believe there'll be something like a HR manager. There'll be a blockchain HR manager. There'll be an AI HR manager, right? So every area is going to get specialized based on domain they are operating in. There won't be a general sales manager. It would be an AI sales manager or a blockchain sales manager or something like that. So all of the folks can specialize. And of course, the technical community, the engineers, the folks who are able to do coding or pick up coding, they have a technical career track to follow. So you can be, there are two major things which we see in overall data science, big data, Hadoop, Spark, Kafka Hive, and then of course the area of machine learning, deep learning. This is where AI comes in. So obviously, I would recommend directly going to this machine learning, deep learning. No need to route yourself through the big data world, which is slightly old now. And big data is still hot area, but now AI is hotter, okay? And it's going to get hotter and hotter. There's a third box here which I should probably draw. You can be a data visualization and reporting expert, right? There is something called Tableau, as some of you might know, Tableau, SPSS, right? I should probably put that box here. Cognos, these are AI and analytics tools. And so that's a reporting and visualization track. This is a big data track which requires big data programming, Hadoop, Spark, Kafka Hive, etc. And finally, the machine learning track, here we use Python or R-based programming. I would, of course, push you or recommend you ML and DL track. This is the hottest area now. But if you don't like that area, you can be in big data and Tableau reporting, SPSS. Those are also excellent careers to pursue. All right, nothing wrong with any of these. And within ML DL, we have expanded it here. You can specialize in predictive analytics, computer vision, natural language processing, speech chatbots, etc., robotics, driverless cars, and many other areas. All right. So I hope this answers some of your questions which were being asked. Let me continue here. So as I said, you know, we in self-stat, we learn, you know, one of the best curriculums in machine learning and deep learning. So we have two online courses which can be taken anywhere. So we have first course machine learning, second course deep learning. So these are available as pre-recorded videos, and I personally check each student's assignment, okay? So not only we provide you recorded videos, we provide you programming assignments in all of our courses, and me and my team of you know, AI and data scientists, we check each and every assignment and give you a grade of A, B, or C. So if you do the machine learning course, you can get the ML certificate. If you do a deep learning course, you'll get the DL certificate. And then all of them are hands-on courses. These are technical courses. We use Python and TensorFlow for all of our programs, right, and projects. We use Python and TensorFlow, Python and scikit-learn for machine learning, TensorFlow for deep learning. And then if you do both the courses with us, we also issue a PG certificate in AI. So this is almost a two-month course, the first one. The second one takes almost 2.5 to 3 months. So it's almost a five-month curriculum program. And after that, we have now launched new programs, which we refer to as AI internship. We have an AI internship for advanced project, you know, AI internship with our AI lab, where you can work on advanced projects and practice. But for that, you have to be deep learning expert. And after that, we also have a research fellow program, self-stat research fellow. So self-stat research fellow is like a mini PhD in machine learning. Okay. So we have four programs now. Even though this diagram only shows two, the machine learning course, deep learning course, AI project internship, and finally a research fellowship. So AI internship is almost 3 month program. The research fellowship is almost 6 month program. So research fellowship is like the closest we can get to a PhD in machine learning. Okay, we cannot substitute an Ivy League PhD here, but you know it, that's just we are trying to get close to it. Okay, because not everybody can enroll in a Stanford or MIT or Indian Institute of Technology PhD program. So we have an offering in the private sector here. And we train our students intensely. We create AI superstars. So we run an AI research lab, and all of our students are part of our AI research lab wherever they are. And in our research lab, we provide advanced AI webinars, and you know, advanced AI project content and information. Okay. So let me continue here, then I'll come to a lot of the questions which are coming in. So you can see the curriculum for the machine learning program, right? So introduction, then maths refresher, as I was saying, then we go on to supervised versus unsupervised learning, then all these ML algorithms, right? Then this is the deep learning course with TensorFlow. Here we start with, you know, artificial neural networks, and then introduce the TensorFlow API from Google, open source API in deep learning. Then we go on to convolutional neural network, recurrent neural networks, NLP, etc. So there are two different courses we have, classic machine learning and deep learning. Okay, these are very intense courses, right? So machine learning DL is hard. It's not for the weak of heart, right? It is hard. And that's why the salaries are so high, because folks who can train themselves in this area will be much in demand. So as I was saying, everything we do is supported by our AI research lab, which is one of the most advanced AI research groups in the world. Earlier, it was only available in Bengaluru. Now we have global membership for AI lab, and we do advanced AI webinars just for our lab members, right? So just like the webinar today, I have an AI lab webinar scheduled next Monday, but that is only for our lab members. So if you are a student for one of our programs, you are automatically our AI lab member, but you can also become AI lab member without being a student. There's a small token fee involved, a monthly fee to be an AI lab member. Okay, and you can find information on our meetup page for all of them. Our next Bangalore chapter meetup for the AI lab is on this Saturday. So those of you who are in Bengaluru, India, I welcome you to attend our AI lab, you know. So the first meeting, you know, is complimentary. If you like what you see in the Saturday AI lab, then you can become a member if you like. Okay. So now I'll take up some questions, then I'll quickly show you a few demos of machine learning and deep learning given time. So are you going to make this recording available on yes, so I recorded this session. It will be available on our YouTube channel. How do we get the data for the model you create? Let's take diabetes model, for example, as you just explained. So data acquisition is a big problem for AI and machine learning. Yes, you have to work with the customers in that segment, right? If you want diabetes prediction model, you'll have to source it from somewhere, either a university hospital or a hospital or a clinic who's willing to share data, right? So you have to take care of data privacy issues and all that based on which country you are in. Timing, question mark, I didn't know timing of what. So all of our courses are self-paced courses. You can start them anytime and end, you know, at your pace. So there's no like any fixed course where you have to attend on certain days. So you can start our courses. So they are self-paced courses with say pre-recorded videos. But as I said, I mentor each and every student. We check each person's assignment and give them a grade of A, B, or C. I'm good at ML and DL. Can I apply for AI internship research fellow? Absolutely. So we will take your interview for admission into our AI internship course or research fellow course. We interview people. So if you feel you are expert in ML, DL, you will be eligible to apply for AI internship, definitely. With Julia gaining traction, how relevant will Python be for ML and AI in the future? See, these programming languages keep changing, right? So we, in way back in 90s, we used to work on C, C++, Unix shell programming, right? And then came Visual Basic and then Power Builder, some of you might remember. Then came Java. These things keep changing, but the algorithms will remain same. So currently Python is very popular. Earlier R was more popular in statistical modeling. Julia or whatever comes up now, you know, it will be just programming language structure change, but the algorithmically it will be very similar, isn't it? But as of now, Python is very dominant for machine learning and deep learning. If Julia comes along, that's fine. I'm sure it's another programming language, we can pick it up, but the algorithms will remain the same. Timing of the training, well, it's not any specific timing. As I said, it's self-paced course. You can start anytime and finish at your pace. So if you enroll, we'll be sending you pre-recorded videos along with some programming, you know, projects which you'll have to do and submit the programming assignments. And me and my team will be checking your programming assignment, give you a grade of A, B, or C along with the correct solution as well. Okay. What is the fee for all these courses? So our ML course is priced at the Indian rupees 4,000 plus tax, right? It's very economical. A deep learning course in self-paced mode is now priced at rupees 8,000 plus tax. And our AI internship currently has an offer pricing of 15,000 rupees plus tax, and which is almost around $150. and then you know, then our fellowship program is priced at 30,000 rupees plus tax. Okay, so within about 60,000 you can enroll in the entire one year program, 1.5 year program, in less than 60,000 Indian rupees. So price wise we are probably one of the most economical in the market, you know. I'm a Java developer. Shall I move to Python and machine learning? See, I would say AI and machine learning is the hottest career going forward. The hottest career, okay? So I do not think there is any job interview you are going to attend where they will not be interested in seeing if you know machine learning. Every company is looking for machine learning data scientists. It's not like we won't need web developers. We need mobile app developers, cloud developers, you know, Java developers. We still need them. But you know that the thing in technology is you have to always update yourself on the latest skill set. Whatever is the hottest area, you have to keep reskilling. So reskilling is the only game in IT world, as you know. So I definitely recommend, you know, pursuing an AI ML career. It's the next hottest thing coming up. How to get help if I cannot understand something? So in self-learning session, see, this is where all of our courses are supported by me and my team of AI experts. So if you are doing our courses, we are guiding you. If you get stuck on a programming assignment or have a question, we'll be personally talking to you and coaching you. Unlike other e-learning companies where you have to pretty much figure it out on your own. All of our programs are instructor and mentor supported. We'll never leave you alone, okay? Are you providing any interview options? So we have a huge community of AI, you know, professionals who work in different companies. We have an AI research lab where we get people from different companies. So if you are our student, you definitely get exposed to broad AI community and you can find jobs through our network as well. Okay, we do not guarantee jobs, but our AI community is so strong that you are pretty much finding a representative from every major company, you know, you can imagine, who are operating in AI space. How are careers for a non-tech stream like AI consultant, and what courses are there? So I can take this up offline. We in CellShed only have technical courses, but if you are not a technical person and you want to be an AI solution specialist or AI consultant, then I can help guide you. Kindly contact me offline and we can have a discussion on that. There are quite a few pathways how to be an AI specialist if you are not technical. Do we need to learn Python before enrolling in your course? Not at all. If you know any programming language, whether it be PHP, Java, C, C++, so because Python is the easiest part in machine learning. The programming is the easy part. The algo is the hardest part. That we will teach you, okay? Even if you're coming from .NET, C, C#, Word, it doesn't matter. If you know C#, Python will be a piece of cake for you. C#, Python is much easier than Java or C#, okay? It's object-oriented language and they have abstracted out a lot of the complexity we have Java and C. So once you see the Python file, it will look just like an object-oriented program you would have seen in C# or Java, or even simpler than that. In case I register for AI lab and don't attend coding hours for AI lab, do I get recording for the same? See, if you are in Bengaluru, India, then you can attend our Saturday AI lab sessions, right? And if you are remote, you are anyway part of our weekly advanced AI webinars, okay? And we'll be, so all our AI lab members are working on two assignments. One is a project, advanced AI project. The second is the research paper review. So as I said, we are in a research group in the AI lab. So we are researching the latest and greatest AI research coming out and always remaining on the cutting edge of the latest inventions in this space. So each member of the AI lab has two assignments. One is advanced project development activity. The second is AI, you know, a research paper review. Whether you are in Bengaluru or anywhere in the world, you will still have the two projects. And we'll be doing a status call every week. And plus we have a series of advanced AI webinars lined up for our AI lab members. So even if you are abroad in other countries of the world, you can attend, be our AI lab member and attend our advanced AI webinar series. So those webinars are not open to the community. Like today's webinar is open to anybody, right? But the next Monday webinar is only for AI lab members. It's an advanced AI webinar on convolutional neural networks and computer vision technology. Okay, so it doesn't matter where you are, you can be an AI lab member and benefit from it. Okay, can you suggest any ebooks for data science? So, you know, I suggest, let me just respond to that. A book by Aurelien Giron is pretty good, one of the most popular book, right? I just sent you all the name of the author, Aurelien Giron. Another one is, you know, Sebastian Rasca. These two are probably the most popular books, you know, for AI and machine learning, okay? The most popular books. So you can find these on Amazon or Flipkart website, as the case may be. And these two are the most popular books for machine learning and deep learning. So there are a lot of other books, but these two are highly recommended. But you know, these machine learning, deep learning, you cannot learn on your own easily. You need instructor support. So many folks who are certified on Coursera, Udacity are still enrolled in our courses because nobody taught them there, right? Here we mentor each and every student. Machine learning, deep learning requires in-person mentoring, okay? You cannot become a master just by doing self-paced online courses. So all of our courses are mentor and instructor supported, okay? Do you think there is a scope for the people as technical application support? For example, supporting AI or ML. As I said, everybody who is in IT or engineering sector has scope in AI ML. So if you are the whole DevOps lifecycle, if you are in technical application support domain, the whole DevOps is going the AI way, right? Now we also call it data ops, the lifecycle of data in DevOps. So the whole SDLC is being automated with machine learning and deep learning now. You know, also cyber attacks in technical support, right? Hacking attacks, all being using AI for detecting cyber attacks now. So anybody from IT world is eligible for AI ML technical career. I'm a mechanical design engineer. I would like to go into automation and robotics. Yes, absolutely. So we are experts in reskilling people. You know, so we have folks who have different kind of background and we reskill them in machine learning, deep learning. Absolutely. If you are a mechanical design engineer, you will be absolutely fascinated by the concept of machine learning because it brings back all the concepts of engineering, physics, and applied mathematics back to the world, right? So now you will understand why we studied all this maths in high school, why we studied engineering physics in first year of engineering college. All of that will come into play because most of these algorithms find their basis in, you know, biological neural networks and engineering physics and applied mathematics. Okay, so if you are from mechanical, chemical, civil engineering domain or even electrical, you'll find so much which you will be able to relate to. Okay, because it's all engineering, it's all applied mathematics at the end of the day. Okay, any other questions for now? Okay, let me take you to one or two quick demos. In interest of time, I can't show too many, but just show you one or two quick demos. So I'm showing you a linear regression, you know, problem. So, you know, in machine learning, we train it on a data set, right? So this is a data set provided to us. It's a Microsoft Excel comma separated file. And you can see this is a house price prediction model. So I am provided, you know, these data samples. So each row represents one house. I am provided the area and square foot of the house. Let me just increase the font a little bit here. So we are provided the area of the house, the square footage of the house, and then the price in dollars, right? So for a 2000 square foot house, the price is $88,600. For a 1600 square foot house, the price is $71,600. So this is historical house price data given. For example, this could be a city in New York, right? This data could be from New York housing department, right? And we are given lots of samples, exactly 40 samples in this case, minus the headline row, so 41, but it's one is headline, the title row, so it is 40 samples. This is not enough for commercial machine learning training. This is very small amount of data. But for our toy program here, this will suffice. So let me train a regression model on this. So what we do is split this data into training and test data. So we train the model on, let's say, 80% of that provided data. Out of 40 rows, I'll be using, let's say, you know, 32 or 36 rows for training. And the remaining 8 rows, like which is 25% of the data, I'll keep for 20% of the data, I'll keep for testing step. So now, given those two features, area of the flat, and given that feature area of the flat and the output price for each flat or apartment, you can see it found the equation of the red line and it plotted the red line on the input samples which represent the green dot, right? This is on the training data, not the headline yet. This is based on the training data, which is about 32 rows out of the 40 rows. Okay. Now I'm going to superimpose this red line on my test data samples and see if it fits. And this is what we did next. So I superimposed the equation of the red line on the test data. Notice the title here, test data, right? Test result. So you can see the line approximately fits. Obviously, the train model, the red line, which we call as the train model, does not pass through all the data samples, but it fits them somewhat approximately. So this model could be, for example, 70 to 80% accurate, isn't it? So it is not completely pass. It cannot. I mean, there cannot be a single line which will pass through all those green dots, right? It will be very haphazard line, like a child trying to connect the dots. So in machine learning, we accept compromise and we will deal with approximate models because we want to have a practical equation of a line. If I draw a haphazard line, I cannot find the equation of that line, isn't it? So this was a house price prediction model, okay? Now, if I were to do the same thing with a polynomial regression, what is polynomial regression? When the relationship when x and y follow the polynomial curve, y is equal to wx squared, right? So x to the power of 2. So in that case, what will happen? The data set will look slightly different. It won't be a straight line. So you can see the training data set, the red dots, is on a curvature. So a linear regression line, which is the blue line, is not satisfying the dots, isn't it? So I have to find a polynomial regression curve. So now we trained a polynomial regressor, the green line, which is approximating the red dots in a better way, right? This is called polynomial regression. Here the relationship between x and y is equal to, so y is equal to, let's say 7x square. So instead of just 7x, it is 7x square, right? What is a polynomial relationship? Polynomial relationship is something like W is a 2-degree polynomial, so it's to the power of 2, right? If it is to the power of 3, if it was to the power of 3, then the line will look like this. If it is to the power of 4, then it will look like this, okay? So these are called polynomial expressions. There's a curvature in the line fitment. So I hope this is clear. Any questions on this? And then I'm trying to predict, you know, output insurance premium for certain age of a person. So this is insurance premium prediction model using linear regression first and then polynomial regression. All right. So the polynomial regression predicts a better value because it fits on the curvature line. Okay. One more small example. For example, image recognition or object detection. So here I am given, you know, house and boat image data. I'll show you the images. So these are, you know, training images given to me of lots of kinds of boats. These are some nice boats one would like to acquire, isn't it? On a lake in Europe, if you will. Right? So there are lots of nice boats shown here. And then we are also given lots of nice house views. Even these one would like to acquire, isn't it? Nice houses here. Some of them have a swimming pool, right? You also have a White House here, so you don't want to go there. So anyway, so then you have equivalent test data. So these are test images. So I have a training data and then I have a test data. So I'll train an image recognition model using the training data and then use it to predict the accuracy on the test data. All right. So this is how this model goes. So in interest of time, I won't run it now. It will take a long time to train this model, but you kind of get an idea how object detection might work, right? So I'm training a model which can detect boats versus houses. So we call it a house and boat model, boats versus houses, right? House and boat model. So this is an object detection model using computer vision. Okay. I am open to any questions now. all of you are still sticking in. Thanks for standing by, even though we are over the time limit. Any final questions? Okay, so in that case, I wish you goodbye, a very happy new year. And well, there's a question which came up. Let me see. Well, just thanks. Okay, thank you very much. So have a very good night and have a very happy new year. And I hope to see you in our future webinars and also joining one of our courses or lab membership. If you have any questions, you can contact us offline. For those of you who are in the Western countries, have a very good day. I'll see you next time.